Hi, Paul here from Easy Composites, and today we're going to be looking at resin cast tooling. Now this is quite an unconventional tooling or mold making method in composites, but because it creates very strong, stable and block-like molds, it is very well suited to a two-part compression mold process. The principle of match tooling is to have a female tool and then a smaller male tool, and it's the difference in size there that gives you the cavity that creates the final part. A really important feature when you're making compression mold tools like this is to add an extension around the perimeter of the part on the closure line. And that extension acts like a piston inside a cylinder, so it's very closely fitting with the female tool. And as you clamp down on this, the fiber will be pushed down into the mold, forced into any cavities, then any excess resin that you've got will squeeze out from that small gap in between the two tools, leaving you with the optimal resin to fiber ratio. In a later video, we will go on and use these tools to produce this forged carbon fiber part, which has a molded surface on both sides. The pattern that we'll use to create the tools is a pre-existing injection molding. So we're going to be taking one side of the tool from this side of the part, and then the B side of the tool will come from the reverse, and that will create the offset that we need. Equally though, you could use any conventional pattern making process to make your pattern, or indeed just directly 3D print it. In summary, the process involves adding an extension of plasticine around the perimeter of the part, creating barriers off that, then casting the A side of the tool. Once this is cured, it can be flipped over, the barriers removed, some release features added, and then the B side can be cast, leaving you with your match tool. The first stage in the process is to prepare the part for release. Now this is made from nylon, so actually we would get quite good natural release from this plastic, but it never hurts to promote that release a little bit more, so we're going to be applying a few coats of number 8 release wax. The wax is applied in the traditional method of just rubbing on a thin coat, allowing this to haze off and then just buffing out with a rag. Now that we've got 5 applications of wax applied, I can be very confident that I'm going to get a good release. Now I'm just going to address and fill in any of the detailed areas that I don't want in the mold. The counterboard holes here, although you possibly could mold them in, it's much easier to do this as a post-machining after the part. So to fill them, I'm just going to use some plasticine and blank off those sections. The plasticine should be pressed firmly in to fully seal the holes. This ensures that no resin will get past. To cut the plasticine, I'm just using a demolding wedge, as they've got a good sharp edge, but being plastic, they won't easily scratch the part. The next thing that we need to consider is the perimeter extension around the outside of the part. Because with the forge process, we need the male and female tools to act like a plunger into one another. We do need to extend this further down to create that sort of piston-like effect. To do that, we're just going to build this up again using plasticine. It might seem quite unusual that I'm completely filling the back of this part. The reason I'm doing that is because when this is surrounded by resin, the resin could potentially leak underneath and get onto the wrong side of the part. By completely filling it, it can't do that, and plasticine can be reused. Now, just using this plastic wedge, I'm just going to go in and trim the edges of the mold down, bearing in mind that we do need to keep that slight degree of draft angle onto the outside edge. The draft angle is very important. If it's too close to parallel, then the mold halves would not easily separate. If it has too much draft angle, on the other hand, there would be too large a gap during closure where the fiber reinforcement may get trapped. Typically, 3 to 5 degrees will produce the best results. Once I've finished with the main plasticine work, I'm just going to go over the whole lot with the release wax again. That'll clean up any of the plasticine off the surface of the pattern, and it'll also give me a chance to just smoothen in some of the plasticine around the outside, because getting these areas completely smooth and level is absolutely critical to ensuring that your two mold halves later will release easily. Now that I've got the part prepped, we can go on and make the barriers or the dams around the outside. For that, I'm just going to use polypropylene sheet, same as we've used for the base on this. Now, polypropylene doesn't need any release agent, as epoxy releases really easily directly from it. I'm going to be supporting these barriers with some blocks. Here I'm using some offcuts of epoxy model board, but equally this could just be a piece of wood. And the purpose of these is to just give some strength and rigidity to these barriers, because they will have all of the weight of the resin built up against them. Once I have the barriers aligned properly, a few spots of hot melt glue are used to tack them in place. To seal it up, I'm just using hot melt glue. It's absolutely essential that you ensure that it's fully sealed around the perimeter because ultimately this has to be watertight to retain the resin. The barrier should now be completely sealed, but to give these additional support, I'm going to bond these blocks in place. What you will notice I've done is just sanded on a chamfer onto the corner of the blocks, and that's just to give space for the bead of hot melt glue that we've got running in the corner. I'm now happy that the barriers are fully sealed and secured, so we can go on and cast the tool half. The resin that we're using for this is the TC80 tool cast. Now this is typically used as tooling in the vacuum forming industry. However, it is equally well suited to composites applications like this. The reason we're using this resin is that it's specifically designed for resin casting, and in a single pour you can go up to 70 millimeters in depth, which is particularly high for an epoxy. This also provides very dimensionally accurate and stable tooling. One thing that is worth bearing in mind though is that it's a heavy resin system. It's got a lot of metal filler in there, and this means that where a typical epoxy might weigh 1.1 kilos per liter, this one weighs 1.7 kilos per liter. So you will need to factor for that in your calculations on volume. For this project, I need 2.5 kilos of resin. I'm just using the standard best practice for epoxy mixing. So accurately weighing out the resin and hardener, thoroughly mixing for 2 to 3 minutes, all the while scraping the sides and bottom of the container, and then pouring this into a second container and mixing again to ensure a complete mix. Although you'll probably get away with just pouring this directly onto your pattern, it's best practice to brush a coat over the surface first, and what that will do is break any surface tension and reduce the likelihood that you'll get any air bubbles trapped on the surface of your final mould. So that's the resin cast, so we've completely buried the part now, but we can just check here into the top that we've got at least 10 millimeters of thickness. In this case, we've got around about 12 millimeters. So that should be more than enough strength in that area. I've now left this to cure for 24 hours, so it's gone rock solid, so we can now remove these barriers. The part underneath is now being exposed. This does need to be left in the mould, as we'll be casting the second half of the tool against this to create our mould cavity. Obviously, if you wanted to use the cast resin tooling process for a single-sided mould, for a wet layup or resin infusion, then you would remove the part at this stage and your tool would be done. With the bulk of the plasticine removed, I'm just going to use some of the number 8 release wax just to clean up the last bits. It actually does a really nice job of doing that, and the subsequent release agent that we're going to be putting onto this will be a wax as well, so it won't cause any problems with the release. With all of the plasticine removed, the next thing I'm going to do is take a really close look around the perimeter. Now, although I've put a draft angle onto that, if there are any nibs or any undercuts at all, it will create a lock with the second mould half. So I'm going to go around, any that I spot, I'm just going to flat out with 800 grit paper. So you can see here the sort of thing that would cause us a problem. You can see the resin has just bled under that plasticine and created a notch on the surface. Now it might look very small, but that would cause real problems with the two mould halves releasing from one another. We're almost at the point now where we can go on and cast the second mould half. Now, this particular mould will self-locate. These two mould halves will register to one another and align automatically. However, in the case of some moulds, you might need to create registration points. Now, they're really easily done. All you would do is take a countersink drill and drill some cones into the surface of this casting. And then when you take the second casting, that will follow that contour and create a location between the two mould halves. Let's say we don't need those, but what we do need to do is just make sure that any of these holes here are properly blanked off using plasticine. And there's also a couple of other features that I'm going to get rid of at the same time. And then finally, I'm going to put some locations where we can drive wedges in between these two mould halves to make separating the moulds easier later on. I'm positioning these separation points in from the corners. Generally, it's better not to prise the mould from a corner, as corners are intrinsically weaker points and are therefore more likely to break. With that now all prepped up, we can go on and attach the barriers around the outside. For that, I'm just going to use double-sided tape and then seal it with hot melt glue. Although it would be okay to seal the barriers with a bead of adhesive on the inside, I prefer, where possible, to seal the barriers on the outside, as this leaves a neater edge on the casting. With the barriers now attached and sealed, I'm going to go around with some filleting wax just to completely seal the intersection between the barrier and the casting. This will stop any resin dropping down that gap. I'm using filleting wax as opposed to plasticine because it's much more pliable than plasticine. So when you're working in very fine gaps like this, it's much less likely to peel out and makes a neater job. Before going on to cast the second side of this tool, I now need to apply a release agent. And for the first side, I used a number 8 release wax, and this is typical in composites. But for this second half, I'm going to use an RW4. This is a high build spray wax, and it provides a thick barrier and is particularly good at releasing rigid castings from one another. However, it doesn't provide the best surface finish, and that's why I didn't use it on the A side of the tool. But on the B side, I'm not too worried about the slight texture that it's going to leave. To apply it, it's simply a case of spraying a thin film, allowing it to dry, and then repeating until you've built up the barrier thickness you want. Typically, that's going to be 3 or 4 coats. Now that the RW4 wax has had time to fully dry onto the surface, we can continue on and cast the second half. Now that's done in just the same way as the first time, with a 2.5 kilo batch of the TC80 resin. While we're on the subject, this tool casting resin has a service temperature of 80 degrees C, meaning that whilst it is suitable for all ambient temperature processes, it's not really well suited to pre-preg tooling, unless you only need a low temperature cure cycle below 80. With the barriers removed, we can now look at separating these two mould halves. Now, we could at this stage just take a wedge, drive it in with a mallet, and these mould halves would probably separate perfectly well. But what I'm going to do to give these moulds extra durability is bond on some aluminium plates onto either side. And what this will do is it will give us further strength in these castings and reduce the risk of them cracking when you're driving in separation wedges. Now, there are a few ways you could do this. So you could bond an aluminium or a steel plate onto it. You could use a heavy piece of timber, or very simply, you could increase the thickness of your casting, which would give it that extra strength. So to prepare these for bonding, I'm just going to flat out the surfaces and key them, and then finally bond them using VM100. In this application, you could probably use almost any structural adhesive, but I'm going to use the VM100 because it does a particularly good job of bonding epoxies to aluminium. With these now bonded, we can now separate the mould halves. To remove the part, the perimeter is first loosened with wedges. This initiates the release and makes pulling the part much easier. So here we have our finished cast resin tools. As you can see, they're really solid and stable, and they're going to be more than capable of taking the huge clamping pressure that we'll be putting onto these in a compression molding process. In an upcoming video, that's exactly what we're going to be doing. We're going to be compression molding this forged carbon fiber flywheel cover. In that video, we'll also cover a method of 3D printing tools that are similar to these that would also suit the forged carbon process. So do subscribe if you don't want to miss out. As ever, a huge thank you to all of our customers and subscribers for your support, and we'll see you next time. Of course, all of the equipment and materials that you've seen used in this video can be ordered online from the Easy Composites website. If you're based in the EU, you can now order directly from our Netherlands warehouse on easycomposites.eu. And for the UK and the rest of the world, please visit easycomposites.co.uk.